essence of Buddhism. As such, man exists. He has no center. And as long as there is no solid center is established in you, whatever you will do, it will not be beneficial, neither to you nor to the other. All your social workers, revolutionaries, politicians, they are only the cause of mischief and trouble. No benefit cannot come through them. The world would have been better had there been no leaders. You remember, body and mind are one harmony. Man is psychosomatic. Whatever happens to the body affects the mind and vice versa. Whatever is happening in your body, it affects the mind. On the other hand, whatever happens to the mind, it affects the body. When there is no movement in the body, body attains to stillness. It can remain in one position and is still. Then the mind automatically attains to stillness, the state of no thoughts. If there is movement in the body, the mind automatically attains to actions. In order to attain the stillness of the mind, the cooperation of the body is important. When the body and the mind both attain to stillness, you are established in your center. The sitting down still without any movement is not only the training of the body alone. This is such a state when you can establish your center, you can discover your center, you can attain to inner discipline. Only you are, and you are established in the center, then you know what is the essence of being. You are simply being then. When you are established in your center, then in the real sense there will be humility. Then and only then you can learn, you can surrender. Then the artificial, nothing will remain in you. The ego will vanish. And then the moment you are established in your center, you realize all the that is on the surface and appears to be is false. And then something is born in you. And that which is born in you is the disciplehood. This is the essence of Buddhism. To realize this is the essence of Buddhism. To be a disciple is a great benediction. Through inner discipline alone, you become a disciple, not the way you understand. When you are established in the center, you attain to humility. You are now capable of receiving. You will be empty within. And then the Master can pour Himself into you. In your emptiness, in your utter silence, alone He can reach you. Only then communion is possible. Disciple really means one who is established in the center, who is humble, who is ready to absorb, who is open, who is ready, who is aware, who is not in a hurry, and who is prayerful. Not in a hurry means he can wait as long as it may be necessary. As long as the Master wants him to wait, he can. In the process of yoga, the Master is an important, the most important, really the significant link. And when you are in the company of a person who is already established within, then something begins to happen at your center. And the moment something begins to happen deep within, you are not making any effort, but something is happening, then actually the process of transformation begins. And this is really what is meant by the word satsang. Satsang does not mean a social gathering. Satsang means when in the company of someone who is already established in the center, you begin to feel pulsation, something taking place deep within you. But in the modern terminology, this word satsang is used in a wrong connotation. Satsang means a deep communion. Not that you come and you have a social gathering of any kind. Satsang means to be in the company of the one who is truth, one in whom the truth is assimilated. And then the moment you are open, ready to receive, and if your waiting intensifies, only then you can establish an inner connection. The master is not doing anything. He is simply available. And this is what satsang means. Master is not doing. He is simply available. And when you are open, he begins to flow into you. And that process of flowing into the disciple is satsang. When the disciple is open, ready to receive, the master begins to flow. That is satsang. And in the company of the master, you need not ask anything, you need not learn anything. The moment you can be in the company of the master without asking, without any thinking, without any logic, then the communion can begin, and in that communion, the process of transformation happens. Disciple really means one who is ready to accept, who has become like a womb. And the moment you are a womb, something of the master can enter in it. And this is satsang. Satsang is not a dialogue. Satsang is not a discourse. Yes, there can be a discourse, but discourse is simply a means to prepare you. I am speaking to you because that is the only way of communion. We are not sitting face to face. Then these words create communion of being face to face. All these talks, all these words are simply a technique, a device to establish a communion between you and me. This is the essence of Buddhism. And this is not based in scriptures. I am not teaching you any scriptures or anything. The essence, sutu, the essence of Buddhism is not in the scriptures, not in Buddha. It is something to be understood because it has far-reaching implications. Whatever Buddha has said is as close to truth as possible. Buddha is one of the enlightened masters, but even being close to truth is not true. Even closeness is only a kind of distance. You are close, but you have not be that. So you cannot find the essence of experience of Buddha through the scriptures. That is the ordinary conception of the people, that if you read Buddhism, you become a learned scholar of Buddhism, but you will not know the essence of Buddhism. Osho narrates an anecdote about a Buddhist scholar. In his own words, one great Buddhist monk, Bhadant Anand Kaushalayan, met me by chance in a Buddhist conference in Bodh Gaya. He took me out of the crowd and asked me, "Whatever you were saying is so authoritative, but forgive me for interrupting you. I loved whatever you said, But I have never found in any scripture the stories you were telling. And I am the head of the Buddhist Society of India. I have heard his name. I have read his books. I said it is a great opportunity to meet you. I have loved your books. But I can say that you do not know the essence of Buddhism. Otherwise, you would have understood my stories. It does not matter whether it really happened or not. He said, what do you mean? I said, whatever I have said, if it has not happened, it would have happened. That is what I mean. Even Gautam Buddha cannot deny. It may not happen that I can accept. That is not factual. I do not care much about the facts. To me, truth is something more than fact. Truth is more than a factual incident. It is anything that carries the essence. He said, you are a strange fellow. I have never heard such an idea. He lived in Nagpur. I used to pass Nagpur once in a while. He would always come and he would say, this story I have read in your book. I loved it. But the problem is that it never happened in Buddha's life. I said, for that I am not responsible. If it did not happen, what can I do? It should have happened. You are a learned scholar. You can add it somewhere in the Buddhist scriptures. He said, what are you saying? Nothing can be added to the scriptures. I said, any scripture to which nothing can be added is dead. A scripture is something alive. Gautam Buddha happened 25 centuries back. I can add much more to his teachings. These 25 centuries have not gone by in vain. Since Buddha's advent, consciousness has taken on new tones, has known new skies, has flown farther than ever before. Because of the stupidity that you cannot add anything, all the scriptures have now become dead. And this is what your custodians of the religions are doing. They have made the scriptures almost dead, like a corpse. If Gautam Buddha himself had lived for 25 centuries, do you think he would say the same thing? Life is constantly moving, not static. Certainly, if he had lived for 25 centuries, he would have added much more to those scriptures because Buddha cannot remain without sermon. I go on speaking on a day-to-day basis. And when you collect all these form the important messages. And that talk, that sermon will only stop if I am no more alive physically. Thus, being a Buddha, it is my responsibility to add few things here and there. I take the liberty because I have tasted the same consciousness. You have not tasted the same consciousness. You have not tasted the consciousness, that is why you are worried. You know only the dead scriptures which died 25 centuries ago. I am a living scripture. So is each master. Each master is a living scripture. Indeed, an enlightened one is the only living scripture. His word is a scripture, his message is a scripture. That is why he does not bother about any scriptures. To realize the essence of Buddhism is to realize what Buddha realized. It is to go as deep into yourself as Buddha went in. That is the very essence of disciplehood. That is what you come to be in the company of the Master. That is what is the essence of satsang. Not that you go, there is a social communion, people gather and you have a sermon and you have a social outing and that you call satsang. That is simply you are wasting your time. It is to go as deep into yourself as Buddha went in. That is what I am doing here through these talks, books and meditations, and make one thing absolutely clear, that I am not Buddhist. I do not belong to any dead traditions. For that matter, I am neither Hindu nor Muslim nor Christian nor Buddhist nor Jain. I belong to no dead tradition or dead orthodoxy. There is no need. I am carrying the Buddha within, and there is no need for searching anywhere else. That is indeed the purpose of Zazen, the meditation. To search through all the garbage that you have accumulated down the centuries. You have been here on the earth for 4 million years in different shapes, different bodies and different species. You have gathered so much around your small Buddha that you will have to dig as deep as possible and never waver in digging. One great Sufi mystic, Jalaluddin Rumi, one day took his disciples to a field where a farmer had been trying for months to dig a well. The disciples were feeling a little reluctant. What is the point in going there? Whatever he wants to say, he can say it here. But Jalaluddin insisted, "You come with me. Without coming, you will not understand." What the farmer had done was, he would start digging one place, goes 10 feet, 12 feet, would not find water, he will leave that place and start digging in another place. He had dug about 8 holes and now he was working on the 9th. He has destroyed the whole field. Rumi told his disciples, "Do not be like this idiot. If he had put all his energy into digging one hole, he would have found water, howsoever deep it is. But he has wasted his energy unnecessarily." And this is what everybody is doing. You start, you go a little bit, and then you start again sometimes later, or some years later. You go a little bit from a different direction. These little bits are dangerous. Your effort should be concentrated, and once you start and you have a master in whom you can trust, in whom you can see the realization of a Buddha, then there is no need to go back. There is no need to leave one well, and you can go on digging, even if it takes 30 years, even if it takes lives, but you go on digging in the same place. Then one day you would know the essence of Buddha, but you would not know the Buddhism. Then you yourself will be a Buddha, not Buddhist. And that will be the day when flowers will begin to shower on you, just as these did on Subhuti. The flowers were showering from nowhere. Subhuti was dazed from where the flowers were blossoming. This is the expression of inner blossoming. You have reached to the center. You have attained to the essence of Buddha. You have arrived home, and flowers begin to blossom.